makes sense. Somebody that was in the sea service. Okay. Okay, good morning again, everyone. We're getting around 10:30 here, so if you don't mind, I'd like for you to take your seats, and we're going to begin probably one of the most important, popular, sometimes controversial, always exciting panels that we have here at CCME, and that's the Service Chiefs panel. And we are very, very fortunate today to have three outstanding representatives of the military services who are in charge of voluntary education. I have to begin first with two announcements. Obviously, if some of you looked in the previous programs, this panel was to be done by Gunny Sergeant Axel Davila, who was the DOD enlisted representative to our CCME board, did an absolutely outstanding job, did all of the real preliminary legwork and effort on this, and unfortunately isn't able to be here today, but I just wanted to acknowledge him, very much thank the Marine Corps, and very much thank Don Bilodeau for supporting CCME by having someone as fine as Axel as the representative of the enlisted force on our board. And the other announcement I had to make, several people asked me at break to confirm this. I was able to talk briefly with Dr. Wally Boston from AMU, who was on the previous panel. And yeah, indeed, Jim Sweezer is continuing as the AMU chaplain. And those of you that, if you have any issues, if you've done anything bad while you've been here, he told me to tell you that he will be having confessionals this evening at the Destin Bar. So that's all I wanted to mention on that one. Okay, moving right along. This is the Service Chiefs panel, and again, these are the folks that control the voluntary education programs in their various services. They have a lot to do with policy. In many cases, they also have a lot to do with resources, right down to where the rubber meets the road in the education offices. You also have to understand, too, that there are a lot of people above them, and policy decisions these days made on tuition assistance often go at a very high level. So it's not just a one-person thing that's going on any of these decisions. And I want you to keep that in mind, because later on in the panel, we're going to have an opportunity for you to ask questions. You know, whether you're happy or sad or violent, please make sure that you understand the limits that these folks have. And having many years ago sat up here on a similar panel when I was working for the Navy, I do have a stun gun here, and if anybody gets out of place, they're going to get zapped. So be very careful with your questions. Okay, let's begin by introducing our panel members today. And I'm going to actually begin with Dr. Pamela Raymer, who is to my very far left here. And Dr. Raymer is the director of Army Continuing Education System, and she is working out of now Fort Knox, Kentucky. And she has, her bio course is in the program, but I did want to mention a few things. Her EDD is from in supervision with a subspecialty in training and development from the University of Louisville. She has an MS in instructional systems technology from Indiana University. She has an MS in counseling from Baylor University, and a BA in history and political science from the University of Kentucky. And Dr. Raymer was selected as the director of the Army ACES system in November of 2011. And prior to this assignment, she served as the education director for the Army Cadet Command a junior ROTC program, and she is Dean of Academics at the Army Management Staff College from January 2007 to June 2010, launching the Civilian Education Program, which is also a very, very big effort. and those are among the highlights of her career. In a personal sense, she owns three Tennessee walking horses and a hog. Well, actually, I mean a Harley Davidson in this case is what the hog is. She rides a Harley, which will, I know, endear her to several of you out there. Applause for the motorcycle. This is good. We're already off to a good start. And her daughter, Anne, and son-in-law, Chris, and two granddaughters, Samantha and Alexandra, live in Tucson, Arizona. So we're very pleased that Dr. Raymer has joined us today. Next to Dr. Raymer, we have Dr. Jonathan Woods. And since 2012, he's been the Voluntary Education Specialist in the Office of the Deputy Chief of Naval Operations, Manpower, Training, and Education. And Jonathan works out of the D.C. area. In his past life, he's led a very active life, and I think if you talk to him during the break, you'll find out he's also very avocationally very active. I don't know if you sprint around the QBs or anything, you know, over at CNO, but for sure, he very active life. He is a helicopter crewman, a rescue swimmer. So if anybody, you know, falls off the river, you know, dial, give him a text message before you go over. He'll come and get you. Tactics instructor, university professor, curriculum developer, training analyst, and education officer. He holds degrees from Reedley College, Southern Illinois University, Jacksonville University, and the University of Florida. And his decorations include the Navy Meritorious Civilian Service Medal and the Navy Marine Corps Achievement Medal, the Navy Marine Corps Commendation Medal. At home, he and his wife Inga are enjoying raising three small children. I'm surprised you say enjoying. Good for you. That's the spirit. I didn't enjoy raising one child, but anyway, that's good for you. He's an avid runner. I think he did very well last night in the 5K, as I recall. And he does half marathons. And in fact, because of Reagan Airport being closed earlier this week, he actually jogged down the interstate to join us today. So we really appreciate all those efforts. And then certainly last, but certainly not least, we have our other sea service that keeps us safe and, in fact, are our guardians. I think that is the phrase that we like to refer to now to the Coast Guard as our guardians. We have Mr. David Walts. He served for the last 12 years as Deputy Chief of the United States Coast Guard's Force Readiness Command Training Division. As the Deputy Chief, he has either acted as or directly supervised the Coast Guard's voluntary education program and service chief. Dave has served over 45 years in various capacities with the Coast Guard. Mr. Walt is a graduate of the United States Coast Guard Academy, holds master's degree from Webster University. I know we have some Websterites out there, and the Naval Post Graduate School. And on a personal note, he said he and his wife are avid boaters. In fact, lived for several years, I guess in the last assignment, on a boat out in California. So that certainly goes well for somebody that's with the Coast Guard. So let's have a round of applause for all of our panelists. And I know they're happy to be here, right? Or they'll certainly be happy when it's all over. So we do have some questions that we sent out to the gang before the panel, and I'm going to start off with these. And then, as I said, as it progresses, we'll have an opportunity for some open mic questions from the floor, and we'll go from there. So I'm going to start by asking each one of them to give us their perspective on the following. With the current fiscal situation, what changes can the higher education community expect in 2014 with regard to service member education benefits? And if you don't mind, I'll start with you, Dr. Raymer.
Good morning, everyone. I think between saying that we're here to give you some information, he's also saying we're on the hot seat. So we realize probably all of you already know the FY14 changes. And what I do want to say up front is the reason the Army was so late in coming out with the changes is because it was a really difficult decision for Army to make to change the policy. As a result of the TA shutdown in March and April and the turn on, basically Congress mandating that the services turn it back on except for Navy, who did not turn it off, was that it's a program here to stay. The Army supports the tuition assistance program. Obviously, we're in an era of constrained resources, and so we're not unaware of that. But I do want to tell you that as we went through the arduous drill of proposing multiple COAs, courses of action, to the senior leadership to make the decision about the FY14 policies, was that the focus was they, and I know you may find this difficult to believe, said, I don't want to see the savings. I don't want to see the cost savings. I want to see how this COA fits with the intent of the voluntary education program. And so what we did is we went back to the language, and it says it's a voluntary off-duty education program. So as we looked at each COA, those were measured. I mean, we did look at the number of soldiers impacted, but we dropped the savings off of the charts, off of the slides, as we were presenting those options. Every choice was looked at in terms of, does this support the intent of the voluntary off-duty education program? And that is largely the reason the 16 semester hours was chosen vice a dollar amount, is that it wasn't about the money, it was about the number of hours that would be considered a part-time or an off-duty, could support an off-duty education program. And of course, we looked at the average take rate for active, reserve, and component, and we did address it as it impacted each of the components, not just the active component. And it was interesting to us that we had not really put forth a 10-year, which was one of the choices that came out. So that was something that senior leadership came up with, and I think, again, it was related to commitment. But it impacts a very small percent. It's probably less than 2% of the Army is impacted by that 10-year rule, because if tuition assistance wasn't used for the first degree, then soldiers don't have to wait 10 years to get funding for the second degree. The one-year IET, of course, is they want soldiers to be soldierized, and it's 1 year after IET, which is varying lengths. That could be anywhere from after basic and then a advanced individual training or an OSINT program. It could be a very short period of time. So it doesn't even equate to a year for some soldiers. Until we have the March release with Gormy Ed, we won't be able to automatically calculate that. So it may be a little bumpy ride and until we get through that. But what I do want to say again is that TA is here to stay. The Army supports it. In fact, we're talking about the underserved population. That's a term. We had a conference with some of our senior ESOs in December, and they said, well, that's the first time we've ever heard that term, underserved. But we have a large population that are underserved, that are not taking tuition assistance. And it's not to say, again, that there's an endless stream of money, but in terms of the tuition assistance program, it's a very strong program. So we're very confident with that.
Great. Thank you. Dr. Woods, would you like to tell us what's going on with the Navy?
Sure. So the question is, what changes can the higher education community expect for 2040? Before I get into the answer of that, let me just say, I look out on this audience. It's a nearly full house, and I think you should give yourselves a round of applause. This is a great turnout. Thank you. So what that means with such a great turnout is that we got folks that are really, really deeply interested and deeply committed in serving this population of the higher education community, and that is the active duty service member, active duty reserve component, ANG, all of that. So thank you for being here. 14, it looks very stable. We're not expecting any changes for 14. In fact, the Chief of Naval Operations and the Chief of Naval Personnel have both said numerous public forums that TA will remain intact and available. And then they went ahead and put their money where their mouth was in several high-profile demonstrations. For example, when the first round of sequester hit in March, as Dr. Raymer mentioned, we kept the TA program open. It was really important to us. We're asking a lot of our service members. We're asking them, to look left and look right. The guy or gal that was there this time last year may not be there, and guess who's doing their work? You are. So we're asking a lot of our service members. We don't want them to lose out on the benefits that they have, in many cases, joined the service to avail themselves of. Another high-profile example was when the government shut down at the beginning of this fiscal year in October. Even though CNO said TA will remain intact and available, when it's not available because of a funding problem, we made it available retroactively, and a lot of service members took advantage of that. So it's very important. Now, what does 15, 16, 17, the out years look like? I predict they're budgets are going to shrink. It's just a very, very difficult fiscal environment. But here's how Navy is looking philosophically and strategically at managing shrinking budgets. Just like any of us with our personal budgets, if you're facing maybe a reduced budget, what do? You start analyzing where your money goes. You start analyzing what you spend money on. You turn off a few lights. Maybe you look at cutting back on your on entertainment costs, going out to dinner, things like that. You don't say, "Well, we're gonna massively overhaul our lifestyle. We'll sell the house and move out to the country where it may be cheaper. We're going to move our jobs to a state that has no income tax." You don't make these big drastic changes. You start looking at where you can find efficiencies. So that's what we're looking at in anticipation of shrinking budgets in the future years. So what kinds of things might that look like? Well, we've noticed that we could do better maybe with our individual education plans. In fact, I did a study and we found that somewhere in the neighborhood of 70% of our service members that are actively engaged in voluntary education are a little bit off script when it comes to their individual education plans. Well, we coined a term for that. We called it wandering. Now, I heard Dr. Boston use a term earlier today, swirling students. We got that going on, too. We know that most of our students attend somewhere between 3 and 5 institutions during their career before they get to degree attainment. But I'm not talking about swirling when I say wandering. I'm talking about wandering off the map of their individual education plan. That has costs associated with it, so we want to tighten that up. That's some of the things that we're looking at, but I'll talk about others as we go on with our discussion.
Thank you. Mr. Walts, Coast Guard?
Thank you very much. I think to understand the current and the situation and the future, we have to look at the past. I can remember about 2003, 2004 timeframe when the money was flowing just after 9/11, we got a lot of infusion of money into the Coast Guard and DOD as well. And during that time, I went around with my resource director, and we visited our training centers. We have responsibility in my office for training and education. And everybody was patting us on the back and saying, "You guys are doing a great job in there in Washington." And I turned to my resource director and I said, "Allie," I said, "just remember this, because it won't last." I said, "The pendulum will turn," and the pendulum has turned. I used to be able to sit up here with my peers and kind of go, "Nah, nah, nah. We got a service-wide consistent program across the reserve program, across the civilians, and across the active duty." And I can't say that. I have to come now here with hat in hand and say, We looked at the underpinnings of and the legal intent behind tuition assistance with over the years. You know, I sat in this position, and we increased back in 2002 to maintain parity with DOD. We went to 4,500 and up the per credit thing. But now I have to admit to you that we have gone back to the future. Reserve funding is out, civilian funding is out, and we went to a 75-25 government individual cost share. Now, we believe that we believe that's a positive thing in that the service members' contribution, their own contribution toward toward the degree will help focus them on lower cost alternatives. Maybe the colleges and universities who are lower cost in their tuition are and keep them focused on getting their degree in their shortest possible time as well. In that, they could maximize their ACE credits and their CLEP exams, that kind of thing, as the most most cost-efficient way to get credits toward their degree. Now, we're not currently funding graduate degrees. We're funding just bachelor's degrees. We went through a number of iterations on this both last year and then we started to try and get it more static this year. Last year, we were only doing lower level enlisted for undergraduate only. The objective there was to get the most bang for the buck at the lowest level of the organization where they needed it most. We got a lot of flack about that at the end of last fiscal year. We are imminently getting ready to start funding graduate degrees for the active duty members, but the little twist on that is we're only going to fund the first graduate degree, the first master's degree level. So if you got a master's some other way, we're not going to fund that. So we're opening up the pipe a little bit more. Our tuition assistance budget has been cut in half, basically. So we're looking to do those things that will decrease the flow to so that we can use that we have been given, but use it efficiently. We're only paying for the first degree at any level, actually. So if they have an associate's degree from somewhere else, somehow, other way, or a bachelor's degree, the academy graduates, we're not funding tuition assistance for a bachelor's course now for those individuals. The one thing that we've done is we have ramped up the level of approval, and we have said that the commands, we look to the commands to execute, to exert some kind of critical look at the individual's performance and make sure that they're eligible for this benefit. I think that's it.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Walts. We'll go on to our second question now, and if you don't mind, we'll stay with you, Mr. Walts. We'll go down the panel the opposite way this time. And the second question that we have today, maybe this is somewhat a positive one or the future. What are there any new initiatives or programs in the works to assist service members in accomplishing their educational goals?
Well, we have been on this for a little while, a couple years now, but this is, I think, is going to govern a lot of the way we're going to go with the enlisted personnel. With the help of SOC Coast, we have created what we call the Coast Guard Degree Pathways program, and it matches up our ratings with suggested majors and suggested universities and colleges. Take, for instance, a law enforcement specialist. We're going to gear them toward a law enforcement degree or a criminal justice kind of degree with a set of colleges and universities that specialize in that area. or we might do it with a machinery technician, where that would point them toward mechanical type of a degree, or a degree that would lead to some kind of a bachelor of science in some kind of mechanical area. So those are one area that we're looking at right now.
So, Dr. Woods, anything new with the Navy coming up?
Yeah, so being in the role now for, it'll be 2 years in May, I haven't been at the policy and strategy level all that long. So I wanted to go a little bit, as Dave said, back to the future and try to understand a little bit about our past and where we came. And one of the charts I put together ran a 12-year run on TA costs from 1995 to 2007. And that 12-year run, we had 500% escalation in cost. Now, stop and think about that for a second. 500%, five times in a 12-year period. And so the Navy saw this exponential chart just going right off the charts and decided to try to arrest that. So we went through a bunch of management controls in the 2010 timeframe, and they worked. They got costs under controls, and by the way, during that same time, our usage went up by about 50%, so that was good. We got better usage from our out of our service members. We want them to use the benefit, but at a 50% increased usage at a 500% increased cost didn't seem like a positive cost to benefit ratio, and we had double the number of incompletions, non-completions. That's not good at all. So fortunately, the management controls that we put in effect between 2010 and 2012, they really worked. Some of them were misses. We had a couple of misses, but by and large, they worked really well, and they drove our non-completions down, and they drove our costs into an equilibrium, which we're pretty comfortable with right now. However, as we foresee shrinking budgets, we want to maintain that equilibrium, but at a little bit lower level. What that level will be for the out years is hard to see, hard to foresee. But it's been about all of those management controls that I mentioned were affected through administrative message and not through our instruction. And so we're getting ready to release a new instruction that sort of codifies in one place all of the management controls that we engaged in between 2010 and the present. And we're thinking about a few new things to try to just tighten up efficiency, tighten up that wandering that I mentioned a moment ago. For example, we think goals are really important, and we think a uniform approach to articulating individual goals is really critical. That's why we're really excited about the Dante's product, the Cooter Journey. I know Dr. Barry has a number of licenses, tens of thousands of licenses that we want to better utilize so that service members can bring their goal analysis to their first counseling session with them, and we can start from a uniform and consistent starting point, same sheet of music, no matter where they move among Navy college offices or working with a virtual education center and so on as they progress through their academic career. We're also interested in readiness, and so we're pretty excited about some of the readiness products that Dante's has also. We want to take better advantage of that. We want to have that conversation one-on-one, knee-to-knee, between education counselor and the service member to say, listen, are you really ready for college algebra? Hey, shipmate, how long has it been since you've done some kind of an essay? Are you ready for English composition? Let's test and make sure, because we have some readiness products that we really want to work on before we engage in the tuition assistance program. So we're looking at some of those things and putting all of that together in a more standardized and uniform individual education plan. But these kinds of things, I think, will reduce wandering, tighten up the plan, the path, so that sailors don't have to waste their time taking classes that they don't need. So those are some of the things that we're looking at. We also, Dr. Raymer mentioned that Army likes the 16 semester hour rule that we've had in place since about 2006 or so. We like it too. We think that our service members, our sailors, are sailors first and students in their off-duty time, and that's a pretty good number. We like that 16 semester hours. One of the things that Army has that we also like, so they like our 16, we like their 130 and 39 rule. So we're kind of exploring that a little bit. Might that be something that we could go into? If it is, we would add a third tier and maybe say that there might be a cap at the lower division level, a cap at the 100 and 200 level, a cap at the 300 and 400 level, and perhaps a graduate cap. But the concept we really like. So those are some of the things that Navy is thinking about in terms of new initiatives. Okay.
Well, thank you very much. Well, Dr. Raymer, sounds like the Navy is using the Army as a role model. So what new things are going on here with you?
Well, before I go on, though, I do want to take an opportunity so that it gets said. I appreciate what CCME does, and it is an arduous process to get approval to come here because of the conference rules. With that said, CCME needs to give us the agenda next week so that we can start getting permission next year to come. And I'm not kidding, actually. But I do want to say that the professional development, the concurrent sessions, when I looked through the book, I was very impressed with the sessions that you're offering. It's a really difficult choice to go to choose which ones to attend. And so I really thank CCME for all the work that they did with that professional development component. As far as the initiatives, probably the biggest one that I'd like to talk about is our KM, our knowledge management that we want to do in GARMI Ed. What we want, and there's obviously a lot of talk about that, Cord talked about that yesterday, and others have talked about informed consumer. And so we want an informed soldier. We obviously have constraints with the lack of advising because of the reduced number of counselors. But I will say in terms of, maybe that's a question a little bit later on, we think we're holding our own in terms of counselors, but we don't have the sufficient number. And so we do want them to be informed. So one of the things that we're working within GARMI Ed and our IBM partners is, and we prototyped this for that KM solution. And so the intent of this is that before a soldier can open a tuition assistance account, because in the past it was really designed to make it as easy as possible for a soldier to open an account and get them on their way. But this process would force them through some decision making, and even though they're not informed and they're maybe not ready to make all those decisions, many of you have heard me use this Intuit TurboTax analogy, but in sometimes asking the questions, it causes people to stop and think. And so the intent behind this is that as they're forced to be asked these questions, it would help them be a more informed consumer. It isn't intended to be arduous. We're going to limit the time involved, but they would go in and answer some interest questions, and then they would get some information about their skills based on those assessments. And then they would be given some career choices that match those interests. And then some schools would come up and say, okay, these schools offer these kinds of degree programs. And so it's, again, helping them set goals and helping them before they start taking, because obviously you know, and there was talk about that with the earlier panel about soldiers or service members switching schools and the number of changes they make, because they do make frequent changes. But I think much of that is because they don't get good advising up front, and so they get into a program, and then when they get a little bit more informed, they say, okay, well, this is not for me, I need to switch this school. The online environment, of course, has changed the discussion in terms of, it's not about accessibility or which particular institution, but we do hear soldiers say, well, I chose this school and I learned something and now I need to switch to this school. So we're hoping that that KM solution will be a powerful, but a simple but powerful solution to help with that. We talked about, or I talked about probably a couple years ago, marketable degrees. And I heard talk, and I heard Dr. Pruitt talk about vocationalizing higher education. And he talked about 18-year-olds, and then he did go on to talk about adult students and the differences there. You know, when the transition program came along, there was some talk about, well, we're not brokers for job, we're not job brokers for soldiers, but the transition of obviously is a huge issue, especially for the Army. I was just reading on BlackBerry, you know, the number of senior NCOs that are going to be boarded out of the Army because there's a goal to be met. We're, you know, taking huge cuts in the in strength. But so when I talked about before the tuition assistance policy, the Army considers the tuition assistance program an extremely important program. Part of what we went through when we talked about the intent of the program is that how did it fit in the Army Leader Development Strategy and the CSA strategic priorities. And we nested very nicely within the ALDS and the CSA's, the Army's strategic priorities. So it is important, but the Army wants to know what it's getting for its money. And so those soldiers, especially those that are transitioning, obviously are going to make job choices. And people, careers, I mean, they do make different career choices, 8 to 12 or 15 over the course of a lifetime. But we're looking at those. And, of course, the tuition assistance program is not geared or timely necessarily for a transition soldier because if they're going to get out, then, you know, they don't have a lot of opportunity to use the tuition assistance program. But the transition program is transitioning to earlier in the career, you've heard probably soldier for life, and now the term is military life cycle, because all services are looking at moving those transition kinds of programs up to the front of a service member's career so that there are goals that service members are making earlier in the career. So I think that's a huge shift, and it hasn't caught on or hasn't been executed yet, but I think that's a very important part of that. In fact, OSD was questioning whether the higher ed curriculum could be something that would be mandated, and I they asked Army, I assume they went to some of the other services, and we're not sure that that's a good fit right now, but those are the kinds of things that are being talked about, so we're very excited about those kinds of things. The other thing is, I did go to a certificate session yesterday, and Army does pay for certificates, but what she presented as a premise or a concept, I think it can be pretty exciting. And one of the premises is that, and she didn't say this, but if your bachelor's degree is outdated and you're looking for some job skills, maybe a certificate type program is that bridge to a job. And so I think we spent about $10 million in certificates in FY12. I'm not sure exactly what that was last year, but that's something I'm going to take back, and we're going to look at that because I think certificates might be something exploring a little bit more. And again, we're not focused on just job skills, but it is a value. What does the Army get out of the tuition assistance program? As others have talked about quite at length, it is really difficult to come up with metrics that really measure that. There is a research study, I think, that OSD is working, I think, with the Naval Research Center or some folks to try to look at, and going all the way back to the 90s, with the difference that tuition assistance might make.
Okay, thank you very much. I think for the next question, we'll sort of jump around a little bit. We'll let Dr. Wood start it off. And this is something that I think is near and dear to many of you in the room. And for those of us like myself that spent many years working in a base education office as a counselor or as an ESO, I think this is a subject that you're all very interested in, and that's the physical state, so to speak, of education services offices. And so the question is, what can service members and also institutions expect from their local education centers in the future? And obviously a subset of that, will staffing levels be maintained? So, Dr. Woods?
Thank you for the question. just to be clear on how the Navy organizes itself with respect to these things, we organize in tiers, or what we call echelons. And echelon one is the policy and strategy and resources, so the money. Echelon two tends to be process and accountability, and echelon three tends to be the execution of all of that. And so I was talking with Dr. Cropsey, who happened to have Navy execution at the echelon three level yesterday, and we were comparing some numbers. When he had it, echelon one had, I think, three or four people, echelon two had about seven, and echelon three had about 400, 250 of which were counselors, something in that neighborhood. Today, it's one, three, and 157. So we've undergone an awful lot of force shaping. That's a euphemism. We've undergone a lot of force shaping. I'd like to think that our force shaping is complete. And if not complete, one of my goals is to strengthen the field activities, not shrink the field activities. I don't know how successful I'm going to be in that, but it's an agenda item of mine at the resource sponsor level. I want to make sure that there's sufficient folks out there to communicate our policies, our strategies, and the things that we want our sailors to execute. And that's why it's so important to have a relationship with our suppliers out there. You know, if we were an acquisition organization and not a voluntary education organization, we wouldn't be building airplanes or ships or subs ourselves. We would be going to suppliers to do that. It's the same in voluntary education. We don't educate anybody. You educate our sailors. And so you're our suppliers in that endeavor. And the more that our workforce shrinks, the more we rely on you to communicate our policies and understand our policies and communicate those to our sailors. But that probably isn't right. Probably the better way would be to have a sufficient workforce to communicate these things to the sailors directly. So we always say we want our sailors to talk with our Navy education counselors first, then talk to the institutions, but we have to have a sufficient force out there. So to answer the question, I do not see much shrinkage, and if I have anything to say about it, we're going to see a little bit of growth, but I'm not sure about my success level yet.
Well, thank you very much. Mr. Walts, would you like to comment on the Coast Guard education offices?
Yeah, this is the classic good news, bad news situation. In 2002, 2003, we had 19 full-time educational counselors in the Coast Guard. Today, we have 45 full-time educational counselors, and about half of them are here this week. And what I'd like to do is get the Coast Guard contingent to stand up, please.
All the Coast Guard folks, welcome.
In true Coast Guard fashion, we're usually in the back of the room, so we can make a quick exit if we need to. Commander Garces, the CEO of the Institute, told me if you need a lifeline on any hard questions, she'd be happy to throw her staff into that. The ones in uniform are the Coast Guard Institute, led by Commander Garces. Then there's Mr. Padley, who is my program manager, my one person other in the echelon, one. And all the civilian ESOs are my echelon three. And they're, like I said, they're 45 strong now. The bad news situation is that after great efforts of justification and everything else, I'm going to lose about a third of those over the next year or two, and to budget cuts, that kind of thing. So that puts the onus back on the 30 or so that will be left, more than the 19 we had 10 years ago, but still not enough. And that also puts the onus on about our 720 part-time collateral duty ESOs. Also, I want to point out we've got our Educational Advisory Council here that is really a subset of those ESOs, led by Ms. Shelby Dill. And our ESO of the Year, Deborah Stanslick, who is our full-time ESO of the year. Deborah, can you stand up, please? Okay. And that's all I have to say about that.
Well, and before we go on, Mr. Walts, on behalf of CCME, we certainly want to thank you and the Coast Guard for your support in sending so many of your base level folks here. So thank you very, very much for that support. Dr. Raymer, what's going on with the Army?
Well, I indicated already that we think that we'll hold our own. We don't have sufficient numbers of counselors, although we, at my level, POM for, we prepare the budget requirements for all of the program. The execution occurs at MCOM, which is the command out of San Antonio. But and so they went through a personnel assessment and validated. Army did validate a huge number of additional counselor requirements. But what they said was MCOM needed to fund that internally. So it didn't really, it doesn't mean that we're going to get those numbers, but it is an important document and validation, again, of the requirement for a huge number of additional counselors. The education centers are, they're not supplemented, but the higher ed program has put additional instructors and slash counselors of counselors slash instructors in the field to support the higher ed track, the two-day transition program. And so those are located in many cases near education centers. And as part of the requirement for those numbers of counselors, it was to provide follow-up counseling sessions after the instruction, along with some time to do a CUDR assessment. And so we did get a pretty hefty little group of folks to support that that program. So that, in a sense, supplements some of what the education centers are doing. That program is, I think, will be supported. The transition has great support in the Army and the recognition of the importance of that. And I already indicated maybe that higher ed curriculum has a different place, too. So that's all I can add.
Okay, that sounds great. If you don't mind, we'll stay with you, Dr. Raymer, for this next question. And actually, the next several questions are kind of linked together. And all of us went through, I think, a very unusual experience earlier, or I should say last year, with both sequestration and then, for a while, government shutdown. And we know the negative effects that that had on the military's tuition programs and on services from their education centers. And I know currently it appears that, you know, Congress and the administration are all singing kumbaya with each other, but regarding budgets, but who knows, you know, what could happen this year. So the next series of questions that we're going to talk about is related to sort of the what-if area. And the first one, Dr. Raymer, if you would respond, is in the event of military tuition, in the event that military tuition assistance is suspended or drastically reduced, what other options do service members have to finance their education?
Well, I don't really see it ever being suspended. I just don't. Whether we continue with additional limitations, I really don't see that happening. There might be some shifting, but I don't think in total it would have a huge impact because, as I indicated, we have an underserved population. Those who use it very actively and are very vocal about their benefits. But what we want is that it's there for every service member within that eligible population at the time they become eligible. So that is an important part of what we're looking at. But some of the things that some of the edge centers are doing while they're waiting to be eligible for, especially for those that are coming in and after that have to wait for that 1 year after IET, is to take advantage of the exam program, the CLEP, the DSST, and some of the other programs that we do have as part of our what is our VACE program. So it isn't, of course, the TA is the huge program, but there are a number of other programs that can help, and we're trying to ramp up the ACE program. Army has been way behind in getting updated ACE credentials, and part of that is some of the change that's happening within TRADOC, which is where the training institutions are, and primarily most of the credit for courses comes from those institutions. But there's a two-star at TRADOC headquarters that kind of took this on as his special mission. And so for the past year, we have been, or longer, we have been working with him and with ACE and with Dante's to get additional visits. And he's just geared it up again within the last couple of weeks. And we provided a lot of information to him because, and as I mentioned, with our underserved population, we need to look at the MOSs that are using or not using TA. And when we came up with what we think are top 10 TA users against an MOS, although I think we have some things to continue to look at there. But to help them understand or to move forward with that so that they can maximize all the credit that they need.
Okay, if you don't mind, we'll pass it on to Mr. Walts. We'll shake things up here and then go back to you.
Well, as Dr. Raymer mentioned, the CLEPs are a very important program. I won't belabor that one, but the college credit for military training through the awesome Joint Service Transcript Program, we're very much appreciative of that. And Michelle Spires and that effort, we've gone to that as our service transcript, and we're finding that the error rate in there is very good. We're auditing every transcript, and we're finding that that's an outstanding product. And it actually saved us money because we were doing buying a off-the-shelf program to do that before. So that's one area. An area that you probably have similar things in DOD, but we have the Coast Guard Foundation Education Grant Program, where individuals can get a grant for education expenses that are not covered by any other program. And along the lines with that is what we call our Vanderputten Award. Mr. Vanderputten was a Coast Guard member who achieved a degree based on his experience in the Coast Guard and tuition assistance, and he's a great benefactor now because he's made a lot of money in the insurance business. So he's coming back and give us money for helping enlisted along and hoping that somebody can follow in his path in the future. So those are the kind of things that we have in play.
Great. Dr. Woods?
Okay, so going back to the previous panel, Dr. Klinkar talked about looking for some uniformity in a TA policy, and Dr. Pruitt talked about how no two students are the same, and so that sets up a little bit of a disparity there. Are they the same enough for similar policies, or are they so different that from one service to the next, or even within the same service, are they different? Here's what our demographic is. Our average TA user is an E5. 44% of all of our TA users fit into this specific category. It's an E5 over 8. Two-thirds of those E5s over 8 are married with multiple children. And so that's the demographic, for Navy anyway. It's different. I've talked to my cohorts at Marines, at Army, at Air Force, at Coast Guard. It's different at all of the services, but that's what it is for Navy. So that average user is probably in it for the long haul. So over eight, they're starting to think, is this something that I'm going to stick with? What are my promotion chances? Do I have a shot at commissioning? Do I have a shot at making chief petty officer? Or do I have a better chance out in the economy? These are the decisions that an E5 over eight is going to make, or is in the process of making. And so when we think about the possibility of reduced, I mean, there was a lot of volatility last year, so we got a really clean look at what volatility does to decision-making processes when it comes to TA. And actually, maybe I need to rephrase that. There was nothing clean about the volatility last year, but we did get a look at the effect of volatility has on the workforce. What we noticed was when the other services turned off TA because of sequester, our usage skyrocketed. When they turned it back on, our usage skyrocketed. Every change caused our usage to skyrocket. As Dr. Raymer said, TA isn't going anywhere. We may reshape the way we look at it. We may compress our costs a little bit or attempt to find efficiencies here and there. But I don't see it going anywhere in any extended period of time. But having said that, when it does shut off and demand goes up, you got to tell them something. What do you tell that E5 over eight, married with two kids, when they come to you and say, well, listen, I'm on track to graduate this year and I need to take these classes. What are my options? That's the question here. What are my options? We want to be real careful about talking about other options. I very deeply appreciated the comments from the previous panel about FAFSA and student loans. I'm not sure I want to, our workforce counseling folks to take student loans. Maybe I'd rather have them counseling them to, hey, ride this out. The benefit will be back. Take a semester off. Put off your plans a little bit. Probably that's the better message. They have GI Bill availability, but I'm not sure that I want to counsel them to say, hey, go ahead and use your GI Bill right now. They have other plans for that. Sometimes their plans involve after their service, like I used GI Bill after my 4 years of service, and it was really a critically important path to my goal attainment. During that transition period. It's a very, very, I can tell you from personal experience, it's a very difficult transition period, those first few years out of the service if you don't possess a baccalaureate level degree or a credential of some kind. So we want to preserve that benefit, and a lot of them are preserving it for TEB transfers as well, which is legal under Title 38 of the United States Code. So in terms of the options that are out there, probably the best option is, look, it'll be back, stay the course, postpone your plans a little bit. Now, if that's not an option for you, then here's the positives and negatives about some of the other funding sources.
Great, thank you very much. Well, of course, as we well know, for some of the services, when they stopped tuition assistance in sequester, and of course when the government shut down, that was a great jolt to the service members taking programs in voluntary education, and I know it's very early in the fiscal year 14. The first quarter has just come to a conclusion, more or less. We recently saw in the Marine Corps Times an announcement by the Marine Corps that they had significant declines in their enrollments. But I'm wondering, as a result of this sequester and perhaps the government shutdown, do you see any trends this fiscal year regarding your enrollments up to this point? And we could start with Mr. Walts on this one, and then we'll blaze on down the panel.
Well, our only consistent data that we have goes back to FY12, because FY13 was so tumultuous, and as my institute staff has told me many times, it's hard to predict what's going to happen when we have new criteria, new limits, that kind of thing. So we don't know exactly what's going to happen, but I can say what we're going to do, and I've made this point with my chain of command, is we need to steady this out, that the criteria that we apply to this needs to be the same over a period of time, and the members need to know that benefit is out there and what level it's going to be in the future, rather than maritime thing. We don't want to sprint and drift all the time. We want to make sure it's a steady course and speed as we move forward. So that's what I think is important. I mean, the party line is any change to the tuition assistance program going to be made in the best interest of our personnel and mission execution within the constraints or ever tightening environment. I read that. Now, what does that mean? that means that we're going to try to do the best for the most junior people and where the need is the greatest. And I emphasize that we're only funding the first degree at each level. So if you have an associate's degree, we're not going to fund associate's degree TA. We're going to fund bachelor's degree TA if you bring that forward. And shortly, we're going to be doing master's degree if you don't have a master's degree. So that's kind of our thought process, to do the most good for the most people where it's going to help. And we need to... We need to eliminate that that sprint and drift mentality. And I would say, Dr. Woods and I talked about this, to address Dr. Klinkar's challenge for a consistent TA program across the military. I would say that we spent a lot of time on phone calls in the last few months of FY13 and the first month of or two of FY14, where the three of us and the other service chiefs were struggling trying to figure out what we were going to do. And as you can see, we have moved away from a consistent approach in the services. I'm the only one, the Coast Guard is the only one with a cost share out there. There are different criteria across the board in the other services. I can say we tried to go toward a simplistic approach that is easy to enforce, and that's why we ended up where we were. And I'm not sure, Dr. Klinkar, that we're ever going to get to that consistent approach across the board.
So, Dr. Woods, any trends you see so far in the fiscal year with the Navy?
yeah, thanks for the question. It's as I mentioned before, when you see shrinking budgets, you start thinking, where can I find my efficiencies? And you start analyzing what things cost. You know, I consumed how many kilowatt hours on my light bill last year? Well, we're going to fix that. You know, these are the things that you, the thought processes that you go through. And one of the things is I'm analyzing, pouring through this all this data, and you know, data needs to undergo some sort of transformation before it becomes information. And so, I was trying to apply some data transformation processes to make it meaningful to me. And here's one thing I hit on. I found this theme, this rule, two-thirds rule is what I came up with. And it turns out that two-thirds of my users, TA users in the U.S. Navy, are taking 100 and 200 level classes. That's freshman and sophomore level classes. Of those, so excuse me, that's about 36,000 of them. Of those, two-thirds of those are taking those 100, 200 level classes at a four-year institution. The other third, about 12, 14,000, something like that, are taking it at a two-year institution. Now here's the rub. I can remember being an 18-year-old prospective college student, high school senior, sitting around the kitchen table having a conversation with my parents. And I wanted to go, I grew up in California, Central Valley of California, and I wanted to go to UCLA in the worst way. They said, well, that's not what we can afford, but we can afford Reedley College, which is a community college about 15 miles away. So how about this? How about we take care of your first 2 years, and then that defrays the cost down. This is a thought process that, frankly, you start looking at this level as well. We've got two-thirds of our users at a cost, at four-year institutions, for their 100, 200 level courses, at a cost of an average $220 per semester hour. The other third, 100 and 200 level course users, at two-year institutions, costing about an average of $149. Why are we paying such a great difference between the two. Now, and I have a challenge for you. Can I see by a show of hands the number of people out in the audience that represent a two-year institution? Okay, so a smattering of them. Represent a four-year institution? Okay, so my question for you is, are you talking to each other? Because what I'd love to see is I'd love to see the two-year institutions being feeders for the four-year institutions in a 2+2 type arrangement, because I think we can save some money that way. So anyway, those are the thought processes. When you ask me what are the long-term impact of sequestration, that's the kind of thing that I start looking through and thinking about, is how do we find efficiencies that the data may tell us exist, and how do we exploit those efficiencies? How do we find a way to exploit that? That's what I'd like to see.
Thank you. Well, Dr. Raymer, any trends so far and any impact you've seen from sequestration?
Yes, actually, we're probably down about 20% this year. After the TA was turned back on, as Jonathan indicated already, with the Navy, even though they didn't turn it off, we had a huge surge. I mean, we were spending probably 3, 4, 5 times as much on a daily basis as we had spent before it was turned off. But by the end of the year, that wasn't sustained. And so as a result, because Army had gave us more money to provide for what we thought would be a sustained new burn rate. And because it didn't happen, we turned back a big chunk of money in FY13. And so in FY14, again, I think we're down probably about 20%. We look at it on a daily basis, and we report it on a daily basis. And that's pretty much where we are. I've already talked about the underserved population because, again, Army supports the tuition assistance program, and we want those who are eligible to use it to use it.
Okay, great. Now we're down to our final question, and then you get a chance to ask some questions on the floor, and we'll have...
I thought we were going to ask one more question. So I do have an alibi on something that I didn't talk about in terms of an initiative, is the course planner. In fact, Ella Karczewska, who's the Gorami Ed analyst, and she's seated right down here, along with the IBM team, did hold one session. I'm not sure if there was a second session on the course planner. The course planner is something that we're launching in March, and it's related to the degrees, because I thought we were going to be asked the question, what can schools do? What do we want? Mm-hmm. While general studies degrees are not going to go away, and they're a very important part of a soldier's degree program, what we really want are strong degree programs. And we want the, and it is, again, Kurt Coy said yesterday, in terms of those things about marketability and what the labor market wants and needs, even though, again, we're not job brokers. But that strong degree program is very important. And so the course planner is something that's... a mixed blessing maybe in some ways, because initially it's going to require some additional work either on the part of the soldier, the school, or the education counselor. But it's very important to us, because the soldier loads all of their courses into this course planner, and ultimately it's intended to be easier, and also because we want the soldier to really appreciate what they're signing up for and for planning purposes, because we do want a focused soldier in terms of meeting their educational goals.
Great, thank you very much. And now we'll move on to our last question before we open it up to the floor. And this would be, and we'll start again with Dr. Raymer, if you don't mind, but what can CCME member institutions do to better assist service members if there is another time of fiscal constraint?
Well, actually, I was kind of sort of answering that question because I thought we were moving to audience questions. But it is about, as Jonathan indicated, and we all have kind of talked about or have talked about, is the lack of education counselors, because those are intended to be the unbiased, even though we realize that they may have preferences for schools and that sort of thing. But the goal is that they get good advising, and that's not really happening. So the schools... are huge players in that, but we want them to be informed, and we do want them to understand the ramifications. They don't necessarily, I mean, I think most of us who went away as 18-year-olds to college didn't understand accreditation, didn't care about accreditation. It meant, you know, nothing to us. But it is an important part of the decision making in terms of what those things might mean and the transferability. So, again, because they do change degree programs, and I think they just go through a learning process. So we want them to be informed. Part of that program that I talked about, the KM prototype that we're doing within Gorami Ed, we're calling it best value, best fit. It's not always about the money. Obviously, money is a huge thing. And I know that this is, that we're talking about the book issue later, which, Jonathan, I think we actually decided we had something to do during that time, and I'm not sure we're going to be available.
Snow, blame it on the snow.
But I don't want soldiers to make decisions about a school they pick because they get a free book. I want them to be informed. And for fairness across those who charge $68 a semester hour and those who charge $250 a semester hour with a free book, I don't want them to make that decision based on a free book. I realize that $50, and I know books are more than $50, but even $50 can be a showstopper for a soldier wanting to go to school. But there are some consequences for making those decisions up front with choosing that school who may not be the best fit for that soldier in the long term. And so what we do want, and I know many of you do partner because the 2-year to the 4-year, and again what that means, whether we're talking about national or regional accreditation or just the, you know, taking a technical math, it's not an algebra class kinds of discussions, is that openness. And I think somebody kind of alluded to that or was talking about that, maybe it was Elaine Sebo, and that if we partner, and I read some articles in the last couple of weeks on about a different topic actually, but I think the analogy is important, is that don't help my partner because it's competition, but actually what they found is when they partnered, they had increased participation. So I think that we're all in this together. You're wonderful partners. We appreciate everything that you do. We know that you spend a lot of energy, and there's been a lot of worrying, those things that keep people up at night, in terms of tuition assistance and what all that means. But the bottom line is that we're all in it together for the sole purpose of helping educate, whether it's just to educate, but then also to prepare them for a career outside of the military. And in the case of Army now, it is pretty significant for a number of service members who are getting out. A lot of the transition programs were initiated because of the huge unemployment compensation bill. It's still a huge bill. Everything that is needed for education. We've talked a lot about President and Congress. Congress is very much into our business. I mean, we're getting those, not phone calls, but messages on a regular basis to address every little thing and big thing that we're doing. So I assume the other services have the same issue. So that keeps things very exciting at our level. And you know, and I just read on the BlackBerry, passed the House, I think, to charge in-state tuition rates for veterans, and it's unlikely to pass the Senate in that version. They have their own version. So there are a lot of moving pieces to the higher education. But again, I think we do need to partner, and the whole idea of an OSD TA policy, I'm not sure that we'll ever get back to that. Army's different from Navy, et cetera, et cetera. And we have, and I indicated earlier, we're looking at the MOSs and the TA usage. We have the combat arms folks who are actually maybe a much better shape than we originally thought, even in terms of transition, getting jobs, but in terms of take rates for schools, which is something the Navy and the Air Force don't have, because all of their rates and AFCTs, I think it is, translate pretty much to civilian jobs, and our combat arms folks, that doesn't, you don't translate an infantryman to something in the civilian world unless you're talking about a military or police or something like that. But that's what we want from you, is we want to continue to partner and maybe not look at it as us against them. Us
Great.
Against you.
Thank you. Okay. Maybe some quick last thoughts about what institutions can do to help.
Yeah, just a quick thought on that from Navy's perspective. What you can do is start by coming here and talking with us, because, you know, we want to... Yeah, if you can get here because of the snow. But this is a great start, and being here and having the, we want to know what's on your mind, and we want you to know what's on our mind also. And only then, when we have a kind of mutual understanding of what our goals are, can we really partner well for the benefit of our service members. So that's really important to us. And I do want to do one shout out too, to give you an understanding, a perspective of just how limited our folks are out in the field. Will Garcia, are you in the audience today? Will? I don't see him standing up. He's got a spouse on the way in, and so he's trying to make sure that she gets in tonight. But we had a competition. Navy had a competition. We only had so many slots that we could bring here because of the fiscal limit of what you can spend on a conference travel. Will won the Navy Echelon 3 competition for counselors to come out here and experience this. And we went to dinner with him last night, and he was telling us that he's got 17 ships that he's responsible for as one counselor. Now, the average, you know, the average number of people on a ship varies by size, but that's probably several thousand people that he's personally responsible for executing the counseling on. That gives you a perspective and puts a face on just how challenging the message is from Navy policy to the service member, and why it's so important for to us that you all understand what our policies are, why we have them that way, so that our service members get to hear it a second time, perhaps, or maybe even a first time from your advisors. So that's what you can do, is understand mm-hmm. our policies.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Walts, any quick thoughts about institutions, what they can do?
I think we have a partnership here. I've talked about how our budget cuts have demanded that we go to a different approach with the 25% cost share. Mostly to our junior people and to some of our senior people, those expenses that they have, books, tuition that they have to pay, anything over and above the tuition rate that they have to pay, are important. So controlling those costs, reducing them if you can, is a challenge that I would give back to Dr. Klinkar as a challenge to his challenge, give him amount of credit for the prior service that they've had and the training that they've got in the service. We know that's valuable. Help us, and through my institute, my ESOs will help you understand the grants and scholarships that we have available as well. I know possibly Pam, you and I are on opposite ends of the book issue, but I'm hoping we don't get into a Saturday Night Live point and counterpoint, but I think there are some that include books in their tuition, and I think that's a positive thing. I think it reduces the out-of-pocket cost for the individuals. Since I have this 25% cost share, I've even talked to a couple, been to a couple booths where they said, we're waiving that 25% for the Coast Guard students. So that's a good thing. I hope I didn't put them on report, but I think there are some best practices out there, and I would classify them as best practices because I've got one university that in the last year that I have full figures for the year, had one third of our tuition for that year. So somebody is doing something that is attracting the students to their university. So I would just point that out, that there are some best practices out there.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm sure you think we planned it this way. We're down to about the last 10 minutes. But hopefully, if you have some questions, come on up, wave something, and we'll have a mic brought over to you.
All right, I've got the first question. Dr. Raymer, thanks for sharing some insight on the new knowledge management tool. Of course, my question, as it is, Michelle Spires from ACE, I know you can't see me. Does the KM solution also include steps for the soldier to review their JST as part of their self-assessments and decision-making process?
I'm sorry, the reverberation of the mic. I didn't hear what your question, something about JST.
Right, with the new KM solution, they're doing their self-assessment, do they also have to review their JST as part of their self-assessment to become an informed soldier before making decisions on their college steps?
Yes. Well, the prototype is, some of it, of course, will be dependent upon the funding that we have and whether we have our Cadillac model or we have a Chevy model. We're not sure. But absolutely, it will be a part of that, or the goal is to have that a part of that KM solution.
Okay, next question.
Hi, my name is Jim Sweezy. I'm at American Military University. Just kidding. My name is Vernon Taylor of National University, Vice President for National University. First of all, I want to give you accolades for getting up there and being as honest as you can with the current things that's going on. However, I also want to give accolades to the academic institutions in here. And the reason why I want to do that, for the last 30 years, they've been pounded for treating service members the same, no matter what uniform they came into their center. And I would say that right now, we probably have every academic institution in here doing whatever they can, regardless of the service uniform that come through their door. My question is, and this is actually going back to Mr. Walts, basically saying the DOD standardized tuition assistant policy. I believe he's actually eager to try to get to that tuition assistant policy. And is there a way that you can get to that point where when we see a service member, we are dealing with that service member on an equitable basis as you want us to treat them on an equitable basis?
I'm not sure I heard what the question was there.
The question is, how hard are you going to fight for a DOD standardized tuition assistant policy so no matter what uniform an individual is in, that they're getting the same treatment?
Okay, I think that's basically the same as what Dr. Klinker. Well, there's one thing that I didn't address that we're a little bit different about. We're smaller than anybody else, of course, but I sit up here and I represent the education today. When I go back to the office, I'm representing the education and the training environment. So the whole training system works for us as well. And all of our money comes in as in one pot. And so I'm faced with the conundrum of comparing training a boarding officer or training a tactical coxswain in a 40 knot boat to do their job against tuition assistance. And so that's why it's been so difficult for us. Our money doesn't come in just for education. So we had to make those trade-offs, and we even cut back some of the training that was not, we did not consider mission essential. So we've done both. We've cut back training and we've cut back tuition assistance. And that's how we get within my AOR, that's how we got to the decision of cutting back tuition assistance and making that 25-75. So I know the other services didn't go to that, but they also went to some other controls that have limited things as well.
Thank you. We have another question.
Yeah, I'm Bruce Brunson from Tidewater Community College in Norfolk, Virginia. A couple comments about some things you said, too, but one of the things, there's only one day between an active duty and a veteran. And we have 6,000 veterans, 2,000 active duty on campus, plus the spouses. So we do extensive research on success. And I'm not sure the DOD is working very hard to find out why service members are not in veterans being successful at college. I get called all the time to study PTSD with thousands and millions of dollars, but there's not money going to success. One of the examples, for example, we have a large database to take placement tests. Only 20% of the military students place into college math, and of that, 35% fail. So of the ones that come in, it's extensive failure, and academic institutions that do this know that if you take 1 to 2 semesters of having developmental math, only about 15% ever to get a degree. So this is a key why we have so many not completing. The thing about certificates, we're studying very heavily too. But of our ground, I just got the data, and since 2004, Hampton Roads areas has 8,000 plus or minus military getting out of the different services. 75% of those are around 6,000 do not even have an associate's degree. So now you're looking in the Hampton Roads area, a significant volume issue. So what I'm saying here is the DOD really needs to pay close attention and do some research and find out why they're not succeeding at the college level, and also why they are choosing some of the institutions. And for the Navy, what we run into in our geographic area, we're not allowed for the service members to pay the fees. So with fees, it's cheaper to go to Tidewater Community College with fees and a tuition than it is to go to another institution that includes the fees. So they will go there, it will cost the Navy more, and they're losing the opportunity to go to a public college that has automatic articulation to a four-year institute.
Bruce,
so
can
the
you
answer
get to your question?
Question is,
Bruce?
How can you solve that?
Well, thanks for the question. I guess Navy can take that. Yeah, the V in voluntary education stands for voluntary, and so it's hard to decide where, you know, it's hard to impose what we call forcing functions on service members, and it's a moral and ethical conundrum as to whether we would want to in the first place, want to say you will go here versus there because here you have better chances of success. So we struggle with this question. We do research on it. I'll give you an example. We changed over, Chief of Naval Personnel changed over a few months back, and now it's Vice Admiral Bill Moran, but prior to that, it was Vice Admiral Van Buskirk, and the last conversation I had with him before he left, he asked me for trend analysis on completions and versus non-completions. Now, I'm talking about course-by-course completions. And so I gave him trend analysis. I had it off the top of my head. I said, listen, before 2007, it was about 6,000 a year non-completions. Before 2002. Then between 2002 and about 2010, it bumped up to an average of about 11,000 non-completions. And now, I'm happy to report we're down to about 4,000. And I remember he looked up at me and had a little grin on his face. So he was toying with me a little bit. But there was a serious tone underneath it, too. And he looked up at me and he said, and you're proud of that? And I'm proud of the progress we've made, certainly. But I'd like to get the completions better. I'd like to have zero non-completions, wouldn't you? Nobody enrolls in a course with the intent of non-completing. The question of how to increase that is a difficult question. It gets back to the concept of forcing functions, and do we want to engage in forcing functions? What kind of forcing functions am I talking about? Well, Coast Guard has imposed one, and that's the 75-25. In other words, they're forcing their Coast Guardsmen to consider a lot of things, including cost, as a pre-decisional thing. And we hear the concept of cost share and stake in the game an awful lot. And we hear things, you know, one side of the argument says, well, there's already a whole bunch of stake in the game. There's the time that they invest. There's the cost of books. There's the risk of failure and having to pay 100% of it back. All of those are stake in the game. But I'm talking about pre-decisional stake in the game. And if someone has some out-of-pocket up front before they even start, I think probably Dave's getting some bang for the buck out of that on buy-in and saying, look, I'm going to stick to this. I'm going to engage a tutor. If tutoring is available, I'm going to do whatever it takes to pass this course because I've got, you know, an investment in this. So, you know, maybe there's some answers that way. But if the question is, are we looking at completions? Are we trying to do something about completion rates? Absolutely we are. It's a very big topic for us.
Okay. Thank you. And for the sake of time, I'm afraid, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have to end it here today on questions. And if you have any more, you can see.
Learning Journal is calling for manuscripts, and it's appealing that it seems like it